date is November 1st, 2017.
Hello everybody, my name is Markiplier and welcome to Resident Evil 7.
You're scrolling through YouTube, searching for new videos to watch. Maybe Markiplier has posted a video of him playing the new Five Nights at Freddy's, or MatPat has just dropped a new game theory. But you've seen these videos already, and you want something new. You find a video, it's titled Local 58 TV Weather Service. The video is 2 minutes long. You remember hearing something about this Local 58 channel circulating around the internet, and you decide to click the video. This was my first experience with analog horror. Analog horror. What is it exactly? Analog horror is described as a subgenre of horror that can be closely related to the found footage film technique started in the late 90s and early 2000s, with films such as The Blair Witch Project and Cloverfield. Analog horror is mainly found on YouTube, originating with series such as the before-mentioned Local 58, Gemini Home Entertainment, and Petscop. You might be asking what separates analog horror from those early 2000s found footage films. While found footage is exactly what it says it is, footage that was lost and then found, made into a film for people to enjoy on the big screen, analog horror tries to emulate the analog style of early 2000s technology. This includes old VHS tapes, FM radio stations, and even websites. Analog horror has become a cost-effective way for creators on the internet to tell their stories in a unique way that engages the viewer from beginning to end. That is, of course, if they are made well. Look no further than Petscop, an analog horror series based around classic YouTube Let's Plays, with a full game being made just for recording it. Or the more recent Liminal Land, that has its own website dedicated to telling you info about the Liminal Land Park itself. Another thing that sets analog horror apart from most forms of horror is that it is terrifying. When diving into a good analog horror series, I would describe the journey you take with the series as a very personal one. What I mean by this is that most of the time, the analog horror series you are watching places you, the viewer, into the role of the protagonist. You are the one putting the pieces together, and you are important to how the story is told. This isn't always the case, but I find that most analog horror series do use this tactic to invest you in the story, while also creating a personally terrifying experience. But beyond all of this, the best aspect of analog horror is that it will leave you thinking, contemplating, even after the screen is turned off. Series like the Mandela Catalog are great at this. The Mandela Catalog, created by Alex Kister, is one of, if not the most popular analog horror series of all time, with many trying to replicate its success and failing to do so. The Mandela Catalog is analog horror done right. It doesn't assault your senses with loud jump scares or insane gore. It actually shows you very little of its titular monsters, that being the alternates. The Mandela Catalog and analog horror as a whole works so effectively because of this extreme psychological terror. And since these series use the analog style of storytelling, they almost feel nostalgic in a way, like a corrupted memory from the past that is coming to haunt you while you are alone at night in your bed.
Oh, it's The Exorcist!
So now, what if we take all of this away? What if we were to simplify analog horror to its most bare-bones traits and set it in a story that, while still being psychological, is unrelenting, gory, and vicious. With a realistic premise that brings these events to life through sound, text, and paintings. This is The Painter, created by Urban Spook. It is also the most terrifying analog horror series I have ever seen, and one of the most paranoia-inducing pieces of media I have ever viewed. Some are disgusted by the series and its content, while some praise it for being a breath of fresh air in a time where analog horror has become stagnant. In the next segment of this video, we are going to dive into the series and its 7 episodes, one by one, dissecting the story, art, and the series creator, Urban Spook himself. I want to preface that if you have not seen the series, I will be spoiling the entirety of its story, as well as using a lot of footage from it. Which is why I have linked each video of the series in my description, as well as Urban Spook's channel. Go support Urban Spook, if you so please, and without further ado, let's take a psychotic ride through hell itself and dissect The Painter, front to back.
Okay, listen up, and don't you move. Need to take a piss? Hold it. The show's got just 60 seconds to go, but I got a message for all you folks out there in Radio Land. So sit tight and bend an ear. Now's the time for action. Our society is rotten to the core. I'm talking to all the fine, upstanding folks got their welfare cut, got their jobs pulled out from under them. Yeah, you know what to do. Now's the time. Do it.
The first tape within the series is titled Faces. It begins with a warning, much like all the other videos that will follow. 6 months ago, police found 3 paintings stored away in an abandoned storage area, each titled after recent murders. The first victim was Carla Gray, found with 36 stab wounds to the face and all her teeth removed. On the back of the first painting, the title, Carla's Teeth, was written. This is The Painting. The second victim was Jackie Graham, found drowned with 27 stab wounds to the perineum. She was alive during the stabbing. Her painting is titled, Floating Jackie. This is The Painting. The last victim was James Miller, found with his face torn off and his wrists slit open. The autopsy showed that James was alive for several days without a face. The third painting was named James, Secret Face. This is the painting. Two months later, several more paintings were discovered. However, the title of these paintings did not seem to be connected to any known cases at the time. Here are the other paintings and their titles. Wax Doll Tom. Lisa's Secret Face. Hanging Jimmy. Fuck Toy Corey. Daniel After the Fire. Jennifer's Last Stare. Scream, Maggie Scream. After going public with the case and sharing the paintings in hope of saving anyone that may be depicted, the police received three photos in the mail, all of them also titled. The photos appear to depict the following victims: James Miller, Jackie Graham, and Jibby. James. Jackie. Jimmy. If anyone knows anything about the photos or the paintings, please contact this number below. One final painting, titled Self-Portrait, was found 2 days ago. This is the painting. The first tape of the series does a phenomenal job of introducing us to the basic premise and layout of what we can expect from it moving forward. It doesn't take long to see why this series stands out from the crowd of oversaturated analog horror series circulating the internet today. The tape follows the style of a police report put into video form, describing the brutal crimes of a deranged serial killer who likes to paint his victims in artistic representations of their deaths. The first of these victims is Carla Gray, found with 36 stab wounds to the face and all of her teeth ripped out. Next is Jackie, found with 27 stab wounds to the perineum. Her painting depicts her lifeless body, floating in her own blood after being brutally stabbed in an extremely sensitive area of the body. Her death, however, still is not the worst of this tape. James, found with his face ripped off, has suffered the worst, living for several days without his face, his wrists split open, living without being able to blink or have any hope for salvation. It is assumed that he would eventually bleed out due to his wounds. 2 months later, several more paintings were discovered, but seem to have no relations to any murder cases at this current point in time. The police go public with the case in hopes of discovering more about this killer and the potential victims that they are targeting. All the police get after going public is three photos of the victims, James, Jackie, and a new victim, Jimmy, who very well could be related to the Hanging Jimmy painting featured earlier in the video. The killer is taunting the police, leaving a trail in some form of twisted game. The video ends with one final painting, a self-portrait of the killer themselves. Their face, their eyes unblinking, inhuman and dead, stare at the viewer, through the viewer, through you. This leads us to the second tape, titled The Lighthouse. Weeks ago, a police officer named Bill Collins went missing along with his wife and two daughters. Bill had previously discovered this painting in his home, clueless to how it could have ended up there. While searching Bill's house, the police found one of his daughters hanging by the neck from the ceiling in the attic. She was only 2 months old. The Collins family car was found 12 days later by the Oceanside. In the car, the police found a painting titled Long-Necked Angel. Angel was indeed the name of the youngest daughter found in the attic. The search would lead to an old lighthouse standing just a few miles away from the abandoned car. The lighthouse hadn't been used for several years. On the door to the lighthouse, an abstract face was painted in red. This is the painting. Inside, the charred corpse of a missing teenager named Daniel Williams was found. Police later proceeded into the tunnels underneath the lighthouse. Here the police would find two more corpses belonging to Jennifer White and her daughter Lisa White. They had been missing for 7 months. Lastly, the police found a moist barrel emitting a foul stench. The barrel was filled with mangled meat and bones. Tests would later show that it belonged to the Collins family. The tests also showed extreme volumes of amphetamine. Photos of the Collins family moments before death were found scattered around the barrel. Here are the photos. Lastly, there was a fourth photo depicting an unknown face. The lighthouse takes what the previous video introduced and makes it an even more terrifying and unnerving experience. We learn quickly that the killer is not afraid to go after police and their families. This is evident when we are told that Bill Collins, a police officer, has gone missing along with his wife and two daughters. We are told that Bill had discovered the self-portrait painting in his house, supposedly clueless to how it could have gotten there. This is the same painting we saw at the end of Faces. While investigating Bill's house, the police are greeted with a terrifying discovery. Angel, the youngest daughter of Bill, is found hanging from her neck in the attic. We are then told that she was only 2 months old. It is evident that this killer has no boundaries. Nobody is off limits. Not even children. The Collins family car is discovered 12 days later, abandoned on the beach. The painting of Bill Collins' daughter is inside, titled Long-Necked Angel. The ongoing investigation led police to a nearby decommissioned lighthouse, standing a few miles away from the family car. Police find an abstract red face painted on the door. Another self-portrait? Or another victim? Police make their way into the lighthouse and find the corpse of a teenager named Daniel. His corpse is charred and black from a full body burn wound. This connects to the painting, Daniel After the Fire, featured in the previous video. Delving deeper into the tunnels of the lighthouse, they find the corpses of Lisa White and Jennifer White. Two more paintings explained from the previous tape. But the worst is yet to come. The police find a barrel within the tunnels. It emits a foul stench. The wood is moist and slimy. Upon opening the barrel, the room fills with the stench of death, as it is revealed what became of the Collins family. A mangled mass of meat and bones has been shoved in the barrel, nearly causing it to burst. Tests later showed that these remains were indeed what remained of the Collins family. These tests also showed extreme amounts of amphetamine, a drug usually prescribed to help those who struggle with ADHD. But when used in high amounts, such as the amounts found within the barrel, it creates some severe side effects, such as increased heart rate, chills, nausea, vomiting, being shaky or restless, and seeing or hearing things that are not there. The Collins family was not only mutilated beyond recognition and put into a barrel, they were also psychologically tortured before their death. The killer made their last moments a true living hell. Around the barrel, four photos are found depicting the Collins family before their deaths. Presumably, while they were experiencing the side effects of their amphetamine overdose. One last photo was found depicting the killer's face, the painter's face, staring directly into the camera, taunting the police. This leads to the third tape, titled In the Walls. I want to say, before we go any further, I'm going to put a trigger warning before we dive into the next tape. It deals with explicit and brutal violence, specifically towards children, and is definitely one of, if not the darkest video in the series. If you want to skip, I would not blame you. For those of you who are willing to stay though, let's dive into tape 3. Unlike the first two, it has no warning. Ten days ago, the Beck twins went missing. Corey Beck, at age 11, and Margaret Beck, age 11. 5 days later, their bodies were discovered inside an abandoned paper mill factory. However, the state of the bodies were found in a gruesome condition. Only the upper half of Margaret's and the lower body of Corey could be located. The twins' bodies had been sewn together in a sloppy manner. The rest of their bodies have still not been found. Margaret's neck and jaw were broken in several places. A clay brick had violently been shoved down her throat. The word meat had been written on the brick. Corey's genitalia had been removed by a pulling force. One week before their disappearance, Corey had been dared by two of his friends to spend an hour in a remote cabin near Tiger Lake. Allegedly, Corey went inside alone with his digital camera while his friends waited outside. After just 4 minutes, Corey ran out screaming that he had seen a face. According to his friends, Corey's left arm was badly bruised. While investigating the cabin, police found a wardrobe connected to a crawlspace inside the walls. Corey's camera was found on the floor inside this open wall cavity. This is what was on that camera. Thank you. This face is believed to be connected to the disappearance of Corey and Margaret Beck. If you recognize this person, please contact the number below. This tape is terrifying, and is the one that usually turns people away from the series. We start with two missing twins, Corey Beck and Margaret Beck. Both are at age 11. Their bodies, or what was left of them, were found inside an abandoned factory. The state of the bodies is the most gruesome thing we have seen in the series thus far. Both have been viciously sawed in half, with the lower body of Corey and the upper body of Margaret being the only halves that can be located. This is because both halves have been stitched together to create one body. But why does the killer do this? Well, if you will remember, in the first tape of the series, we had two paintings, Fuck Toy Corey and Scream Maggie Scream. This not only explains those paintings, but also why the killer stitched their bodies together. With the information we have going off of the Fuck Toy Corey title, it can be inferred that the killer kidnapped the twins, killed them, and then stitched their bodies together to make one uniform sex doll. Remember, they were just 11 years old. Upon further investigation, it is found that Margaret's neck and jaw have been broken in several places. This is because, as we find out later, a clay brick had been forcefully shoved down her throat. The word meat had been written on the brick. The implications from this are soul-crushingly dark. And it is made all the worse when we are told that Corey's genitalia were removed with a pulling force. Disgusting, I know. However, while this tape is exceedingly dark, it actually gives us a little more insight to the killer. As we are told, a few weeks before Corey and his sister went missing, Corey was dared by his friends to spend an hour in a remote cabin near Tiger Lake. When investigating the location, police found Corey's digital camera inside a cavity within the walls. On that day, Corey went into the cabin and took four pictures. One seems to depict a rock or boulder, maybe on the path leading up to the cabin. Another, a wire with no electricity flowing. The third is a dark doorway or hall. And the fourth, depicting the face of the killer that would end Corey's life a week later. Corey was grabbed by the killer but managed to get away, evident from the bruises on his arm. Dropping his camera, he came running out of the cabin screaming that he had seen a face. He was in the cabin a total of 4 minutes. It can be assumed that after this, the killer tracked down Corey to end his life before word could get out. And sadly, the killer succeeded, also taking Margaret with him. And with this revelation, the tape ends. The most controversial tape in the series has concluded. I will be talking about this controversy in a later segment of the video, when we get to the conclusion of the series thus far. For now, we are going to move on from this tape and delve into tape 4, The Clue. Thank you. Private investigator Sean Kane has been helping police to locate victims connected to several paintings. The last body he found before his disappearance was the body of Tom Harris. The killer had climbed the drain pipe up to the third floor and entered Tom's apartment through his bedroom window. In the living room, a pile of hardened candle wax was found. Inside this pile of wax was the body of Tom Harris. The cause of death was suffocation from the wax. Tom's arms and eyelids had been cut off. A third arm could be found inside the pile of wax. We still do not know who this arm belongs to. One week later, investigator Sean went missing from his home. Neighbors of Sean notified the police after hearing his dog bark for 9 hours. Inside, police found a horrid scene. The dog's legs had all been broken. Although dehydrated and suffering, she was still alive. Blood trails could be found leading from the bedroom to the kitchen. The only clue police could find was that Sean seemed to have deliberately painted the number 2 on the doorframe with his own blood. Inside Sean's bedroom, police found a new titled painting clearly resembling Sean. This is the painting and its title: The Man in the Pipes. The perpetrator had entered Sean's house through the basement. Luckily, Sean had a surveillance camera installed just a few days earlier. Even though the camera had been destroyed, it still caught a photo of the perpetrator. This is the photo. Well, at least they didn't kill the dog. Building off of the lighthouse, we now have an investigator, Sean Kane, being reported missing. He had been helping to track down the painter for several months now, and his most recent finding was that of Tom Harris, probably from the Wax Doll Tom painting featured in the first tape. Tom was killed in his own apartment after the killer climbed a drain pipe and entered the apartment through his window. Tom's body was found stored in a pillar of hardened candle wax, covering his entire body. He died from suffocation in the wax. His eyelids had been sliced off and his arms amputated to add to the pain of the hot wax, blinding him. A strange detail was discovered within this tape, that being that a third arm was found encased in the wax. At this point in time, we are still not sure who this arm belongs to, and there has been no explanation from the series thus far. A week after Tom is discovered, Sean goes missing from his home, and his neighbors call the police after hearing the dog bark for an excruciating 9 hours. The dog is found alive, but with all of her legs broken. Sean is nowhere to be found. The blood trails of the house led to the kitchen, which is where police find their first clue. Sean had written the number 2 on the wall in his own blood. What could this mean? It was clearly deliberate, but why would Sean do this? I will leave it ambiguous for now, but I will say that it comes up later. Inside Sean's bedroom lay a painting, titled The Man in the Pipes. I challenge you to figure out where Sean is. I challenge you. We also learned that before Sean had gone missing, he had installed a home security system, possibly to protect himself from the very killer he was investigating. Before one of the cameras was destroyed, it captured this image. One thing is immediately clear. This person looks very different from the other faces we have seen before. This face is smiling, ecstatic. Not angry like the other self-portrait and photos we have previously gotten, but it is no less threatening. The mouth is agape in a wide and human smile, the eyes staring deep, like a demon coming from the dark. We are left wondering, who is this person? And what could the number 2 mean? That ends the fourth tape, and moves us to tape 5, Witness. Three days ago, Tina Rosenberg was reported missing along with her boyfriend and younger sister. Her boyfriend, Jack Stryker, wanted to take Tina on a South Coast road trip for her 20th birthday. Flora Rosenberg, the younger sister of Tina, was also invited for this road trip. Jack's car was found 2 days ago in the woods. There were signs of a struggle inside the car. There was also a painting. Flower Face Flora. While searching the car, police heard screaming from deeper within the woods. Police followed the screams until they found a grisly sight. Tina was found tied to a tree with her feet and arms cut off. She was still alive and conscious. The mutilated corpse of Flora Rosenberg could also be located. Her head had been smashed with a hammer. Tina told the police that the murderer was still around somewhere, however, no one could be found. After escorting Tina from the scene, the police returned to the car and found another painting. The painting had been put there not too long ago. The title Long Jack had hastily been written on its back. This is the painting. Jack has still not been found. In Tina's own words, this is what happened that night. I remember waking up in the car. Jack was gone, and I could hear someone approaching. Next thing I remember, I was tied to that tree. I was injected with something. I could hear my sister screaming. She was screaming for our mom. I don't know. I remember whispering. And her face. This is a police sketch of the murderer based on Tina's description. Witness is different from the rest of the tapes thus far. Not by changing the entire structure of the videos, but being more subtle and more story focused. The sound design has little to no music, just screams, static, fitting the isolation of its forest setting. We follow a plot similar to that of an 80s slasher film. We are told that 3 days ago, Tina Rosenberg went missing along with her sister Flora and her boyfriend Jack. Jack had planned to take Tina out on a road trip for her 20th birthday. We are shown pictures of Jack, Tina, and Flora. No other text, just the photos and the names of these people. Urban Spook wants us to focus on them. If you look closely, you can catch a little detail on Jack's picture. Did you see it? His picture flickers and goes dark for a quick second. Why this happens is a theory that will come up later. We are told that Jack's car was found in the woods, abandoned, with signs of struggle being left behind. Inside the car, there is a painting titled Flower Face Flora. This is one of the most disturbing paintings we have gotten yet, and one of Urban Spook's best artistic works so far. This is not a good start for our three characters. As police investigate the car and the painting, they hear screaming within the woods. It is a woman, screaming in what sounds like sheer unrelenting terror. They make their way deeper into the woods, following the woman's screams, and they find Tina. She is alive and conscious, but her body is in a grisly condition. The officers now know why she is screaming. She is tied to a tree. Her arms and feet have been cut off. Her blood spills onto the forest floor. Not far, the police discover the brutalized corpse of Flora. She is dead. Her head has been smashed with a hammer. All we get is a blurry portrait of the violence inflicted on this poor girl, nearly unrecognizable. Her face. Oh God, her face. After calming Tina down best they can, she tells the police that the killer is nearby. The police rush the area trying to find this murderer, this monster. But they find no one. Tina is escorted from the scene, and the police return to the car and find another painting, one that has been hastily put there. They were so close to catching this killer, but he slipped away once again. The painting is titled Long Jack, and seems to depict Jack as some kind of worm. Jack? Where is he? Urban Spook tells us, Jack has still not been found. Tina describes what happened that night. She describes waking up in the car, and Jack is already gone. Someone was approaching. Tina recounts that she was then injected with something and woke up to the sound of her sister screaming, tied to the tree. Dazed and confused, Tina could hear Flora screaming, crying for their mother. Tina says that she remembers whispering. An interesting detail. Maybe the killer was speaking to someone under their breath. Someone out of Tina's sight. Maybe this person is Jack. And her face. Oh God, her face. We can infer that Tina is talking about Flora. Tina was forced to watch her sister be brutally killed with a hammer alone in the forest, crying for their mother. The police sketched the killer as described by Tina in her testimony. The sketch has a resemblance to the previous portraits of the killer we have had so far. The questions we are left with is this: where is Jack? And who was the killer whispering to? Well, remember the number 2 Sean had wrote on his wall in the last episode? What this could mean, in correspondence with the security camera photo depicting a completely different person, is that there could be 2 killers out there. And Jack might just be one of them. The next tape, titled Pigs, can effectively serve as a climax point for the series, and you will see why soon. It is without a doubt the most terrifying video of the series, and it is the most intense. I will put another trigger warning before this tape. It is going to get intense. Prepare yourself. Former police officer Ian Ford and his wife May was recently reported missing. When police went to their farm to investigate, they found an awful stench coming from the barn. Inside, they found the brutalized corpse of May Ford. She had been handcuffed to a pole inside of one of the stalls. However, her hands had been ripped right off. Even though her body had been badly mangled, tests showed that she had died from internal bleeding. A dead horse could be found within the same stall. The cause of death was heart failure due to a sildenafil overdose. Inside the milk house, police found a bloody mattress. Sildenafil citrate was found scattered around the mattress, along with used bandages and packets of penicillin. Someone had been sleeping there for some time. The decapitated head of the Ford's granddaughter was found wrapped in a blanket. The head of Fiona Ford. The worst smell came from within the second stall of the barn. Several faces were found nailed to the walls inside of the stall. Some of them belonged to previous victims, malformed beyond recognition. There were also several decapitated pig carcasses. In the middle of the stall lay an abnormally large pig. Its belly had been sliced open and then stitched together again. Stuffed inside the pig carcass, the police found the corpse of Ian Ford. The pig's eyes had been cut out and replaced with the eyes of Fiona Ford. Inside the tack room, police found the rest of Fiona's body along with several disturbing paintings. These paintings depict Fiona, Ian, and May, along with an alarming amount of other victims. Be warned, these images may be very distressing. Here are the paintings and their titles. Damaged tape was found in the mud outside the barn. Even though the tape was almost completely destroyed, police were able to recover some of the footage. This is what was on that tape. Pigs throws us into the deep end. The music lets us know that what we are about to view is going to be intense, and the video delivers. We start with Ian Ford, a retired police officer that is reported missing. The police begin to investigate the Ford's family farm to find any clues as to what might have happened to them. They discover an awful stench coming from the barn. What they find inside is an absolute slaughter, unlike anything we have seen in the series so far. We start with May Ford, presumably Ian Ford's wife. Her body has been brutalized. Her hands dangle from a pole that she was handcuffed to. They have been ripped right off her body. The rest of her body lies mangled and brutalized. However, later tests show that she had died from internal bleeding. A dead horse lies in the same stall. It has died from a heart failure, from a sildenafil overdose. If you don't know what sildenafil is used for, it is used to treat erectile dysfunction, aka penis pills, to the simple man, such as myself. Coupled with May's painting being titled Breeding Mount May, and her death from internal bleeding, the implications are distressing, to say the absolute very least. It can be inferred that the horse was given sildenafil in an amount to keep it, for lack of a better term, ready to go, and May was, well, I'm gonna let you put the pieces together on this one. Within the milk house, a bloody mattress is found, along with packets of penicillin, which is used to treat some various infections. Near the mattress, the decapitated head of the Ford's granddaughter is found wrapped in a blanket. Her eyes have been gouged out, her mouth held open in a silent scream. The worst smell came from the second stall of the barn, where the police found countless faces nailed to the walls, the faces of previous victims decayed and malformed beyond recognition. They were hung along with several decapitated pig heads, leading to an abnormally large pig laying in the center of the stall. Its stomach has been stitched closed, its eyes replaced with those of Fiona Ford. Inside the stomach, the body of Ian Ford is found. Obviously, he is deceased. Despite the depravity of the scene that lays before them, the police push forward into the tack room, where they find several disturbing paintings, many referring to victims that we have not seen yet. These images flash on screen with blaring sound, crushing any hope we had that this person would be caught. The body count of the killer, or killers, is raised to 30-plus people. We see May, Fiona, Ian, and Tina. From what we can see, it seems that Tina did not survive long after she was escorted away from the forest where her sister had died. The final moments of this incredibly distressing experience show us a tape recovered from the crime scene. It is badly damaged, but the police managed to recover some of the footage. The footage shows us the monster behind these killings. He speaks to the camera, but no words are heard, only static through the damaged tape, taunting the police. The man, wearing another person's face, fades into blackness, his eyes still flashing through the darkness. I know that this video is a lot, but stick with me. There are actually interesting developments from it. The killer is deranged, but it seems that they truly have no boundaries, no rules. They kill to kill, nothing more. Or at least, that's what this person does. But what about this Walton Goggins forehead having motherfucker? The current running theory is that at this point in the series, there are two killers. The painter, and what we can infer to be Jack, or Purple Face, or whatever you want to call him. Both killers, but I think that this guy with the forehead is the actual painter. While this guy, wearing the face of his victims, is the one doing most of the killing at this point. I will refer to this character as Jack from now on, because of the clues from the previous video that Urban Spook left for us. It seems that after that video, Jack and the painter made their way to the Fords' farm, and the painter let Jack kill the Fords while he painted their portraits. But Jack? Jack took it too far. He recorded a tape, something that could lead the police back to them. The painter does his best to destroy the tape, and they flee the scene of the slaughter. But what else was on that tape? Well, with the help of the internet, a new development has been made. So here's my question. What if the masked killer is not actually Jack? There was a theory floating around many subreddits related to the series that this video contained Morse code, specifically in these segments that I will play for you now. It seems that some users have been able to decipher this message and reveal a story twist that could change everything. When translated, the Morse code reads, "I am Bill Collins." Bill Collins, the police officer from the lighthouse, the officer who had the self-portrait painting in his house with no explanation, the officer who had a creepy-ass photo of himself displayed at the beginning of the video. I mean, my God, man, who makes a face like that? Theoretically, it is hard to prove that Bill Collins is actually the killer, but there is evidence that could point to it being true. How did Bill's car get onto the beach? He could have driven his car to the lighthouse in an attempt to help the painter and deliver his family to him. The only issue that would arise is now we have no idea who is in the third photo from the lighthouse. It is assumed to be Bill, but who could it be if it isn't? Possibly Jimmy, but That seems like a bit of a stretch. Although it would also explain why the killer has been able to dodge the police so easily, seeing as how Bill Collins is a police officer himself. But I think the most basic theory we can gather from all of this is that the masked killer could just be wearing Bill's face in the tape. At the current moment, we do not have enough knowledge to confirm anything. Moving on from the crazy conspiracy theories, we have one more video left to dive into. It is titled Family. This tape is great and contains something new to the series that hasn't been in it before. That being voice acting. I will put yet another trigger warning here. The next video contains a 911 call made by a victim in their final moments. After some careful consideration, I have decided to include it in my video. The voice actress in this segment does an incredible job and gives a truly terrifying performance. I am warning you now, it sounds extremely real. Over the past few days, there have been numerous gruesome murder reports. One of the victims was the elementary school teacher, Isabel Jackson. Isabel called 911 in the midst of her attack. However, the address she provided led the police to a completely different crime scene. The address belonged to a family of three: Janice, Paul, and their son Zeke. They were expecting a daughter in just a few months. Right outside their home, police found a bloodied garden shear. What awaited the police inside the house was so shocking and repulsive that one of the officers requested a period of leave from duty the very next day. Janice and Paul's bodies were found in the kitchen, both ruthlessly executed. The fetus had violently been cut out from Janice's stomach. Janice was then strangled to death with the umbilical cord. Paul was found dead a few feet away from Janice, tied to the kitchen counter with his mouth sewn shut. The fetus was found in pieces, scattered around the house. During the autopsy, they found the head of the fetus shoved down Paul's throat. He died from asphyxiation, choking on his own unborn daughter. Zeke is still missing. Inside the house, there was also a painting. Its title had been painted over, except for the word pipes. This is the painting. Police later managed to track down the real address of Isabel Jackson, though they were too late. The headless body of Bruce Jackson was found right by the open front door. He had been stabbed in the chest 7 times. Where one would expect to find his head, a painting lay instead. It was titled Infinite Maw Bruce. This is the painting. Isabel was found murdered inside the bathroom. The locked door had been completely destroyed by a hammer drill. Isabel suffered multiple skull fractures, and a hole was drilled directly through her frontal lobe. A rolled-up note had been put inside of the hole. The note read, "I live where I can't breathe, and I eat without teeth. What am I?" A pivotal clue emerged at the crime scene, unraveling new possibilities in the investigation. The presence of two sets of footprints in the blood suggested that there was more than one culprit. The police now firmly believe that whoever is behind these paintings and murders does not work alone. As for why Isabel gave an address leading to another murder scene is still a mystery. Isabel's 911 call stands as one of the most disturbing calls ever recorded. Warning: what you are about to hear may be very distressing. You know, even after viewing these tapes so many times, they never cease to amaze me with just how far Urban Spook is willing to go to disturb the viewer. In this video, we are introduced to Isabel Jackson, an elementary school teacher who fell victim to the killers of this horrifying series. We are told that while she was being attacked, she called 911, but when she was asked about her address, she gave a different one, which led police to a completely different crime scene. This crime scene was the home of a family of three, a father named Paul, a mother named Janice, and their son, Zeke. We are also told that they were expecting a daughter within a few months. The music picks up when we learn this fact, and we soon learn what happened to this family. When the police arrive, they find a pair of bloody garden shears outside the door. Something terrible has happened here. The police go inside. What they find is a scene so horrendous that the very next day, an officer requested a period of leave from duty. After we find out what they found, I can't say I blame them. Inside the house, Paul and Janice lay in the kitchen. Janice's stomach has been violently ripped open. The fetus she carried inside her for months has been torn out of her stomach. Janice has been strangled with the umbilical cord. This explains the Breathless Janus painting from Pigs. As for the fetus, it is found in pieces, scattered around the house like some sick puzzle. The Jigsaw Baby painting is explained. Ooh, this next part. The head of the fetus could not be located until police examined Paul's lifeless body lying not too far from Janice. His mouth is sewn shut, his eyes forced open with prongs, much like his painting in Pigs. The police remove the stitches from Paul's mouth and find that the head of the fetus has been shoved down Paul's throat. He has died from choking on his own unborn daughter. We are told that their son Zeke has still not been found, but judging from his painting featured in Pigs, we can only assume that it did not end well for him. The police also find a painting within the house. Its title has been blacked out, leaving only one word: Pipes. Possibly a reference to the man in the pipes and Sean, who you might remember was never found. The painting seems to depict a decayed face with a dead-eyed expression. This could possibly be a clue left by the killer to go back to Sean's home, or a clue to the whereabouts of Zeke. At the current moment, all we can know for sure is that the killers are leaving clues for the police to find, urging them to move in some sort of direction. What this direction might be is something that is still too ambiguous to know at the current moment. Sometime afterwards, the police track down Isabel's address and infiltrate the house, even though they are of course too late. Bruce Jackson, Isabel's husband, is found decapitated inside the home. A painting lies where his head should be, titled Infinite Ma Bruce. Isabel is found in the bathroom. She is deceased. Her skull has suffered multiple fracture wounds, and a hole has been drilled through her frontal lobe. Within the hole, police find a note inside. It reads, "I live where I can't breathe and eat without teeth. What am I?" I guess the killers think that they're the Riddler now or something. The answer to this riddle is a whale. This matches up with Isabel's painting in Pigs, titled Blowhole Isabel. Another painting explained, and another showcase of how these killers have no care or remorse for the ones they kill, referring to Isabel, a larger woman, as a whale after her death. It's just a sick and twisted joke to these deranged people. And just in case you were still skeptical about there being two killers, the evidence found in this video all but confirms the theories that we've had since tape 4, The Clue. It confirms why Sean wrote the number 2 in his own blood before he died. Within Isabel's crime scene, two distinct sets of footprints can be found, pointing to the conclusion that whoever is committing these acts of violence does not work alone. There are two killers out there, leading the police through crime scene after crime scene, to some conclusion that we do not fully understand yet. As to why Isabel gave Paul and Janice's address over the 911 call is currently another mystery. Maybe she gave the address in a state of panic, but this doesn't really add up or make sense. There seems to be more going on under the surface. If Isabel had said that address in a state of pure terror, why were Paul and Janice already dead when the police arrived? Either she was in on the killer's plan, or there is more information being kept from us that we will find out in the next episodes. Isabel's 911 call is one of the most real voice acting segments I have ever heard. The voice actress, whoever she may be, deserves massive credit for giving a truly terrifying and heartbreaking performance. While each episode gets more and more over the top, Urban Spook has done a great job in rooting the series in a world that feels viscerally real. Isabel's 911 call is a set piece, no doubt, but it is one that shows us the real and truly evil acts of violence that these killers commit, and why they are the antagonists. They are not like Jeff the Killer or Freddy Krueger. These are killers that will not be glorified in pop culture. They will be feared and rooted against. I will endlessly praise the series, even though in some ways I believe it goes too far in some regards. But who cares what I think? Nowadays on the internet, if you have an opinion, someone will be willing to support it. The painter and Urban Spook himself are not strangers to controversy, for obvious reasons. The insane levels of violence displayed in this series is very different from the scope of analog horror as a whole, and has ruffled the feathers of many. People have questioned, how far is too far? How could someone make something so vile, monetize it, by putting these vile works onto shirts and posters for people to buy? Is Urban Spook in the wrong for doing this? Well, now that we are properly acquainted with the series, I would like to explore Urban Spook as a person. His inspirations for the series, his reasoning behind making it, in order to really shed light on both sides of the argument, and maybe come to some sort of conclusion. All in the next segment of this video. After viewing the series, I was left with many feelings. I was disgusted, curious, and paranoid. Disgusted because of the intense violence that I had just witnessed. Curious because I wanted to know more about the series and Urban Spook himself. And paranoid because I felt like I was being watched. One thing above all that I think most of us can agree on is that the series is a genuinely disturbing and terrifying experience that will make even the most hardened horror veterans, such as myself, feel uncomfortable, at the very least. It doesn't just feel scary, it feels wrong. It feels off in the same way that watching The Ring for the first time does. Every aspect of the series is made to make you feel as paranoid as possible. And the lingering sense of dread I felt after viewing the series for the first time, sitting alone in my home as the sun dove from the sky outside and gave way to black, is one of the most primal fears I have felt in a long time. And it is a fear that followed me not for one day, but for weeks. I would get home after work, days after viewing these videos, and just turn on each light leading to my bedroom. And then I would turn on the TV just to keep myself out of the deafening silence of my own home. To put it into simple terms, it messed with me. A lot. And as someone who is a huge fan of the horror genre, it still amazes me that even after watching all the crazy stuff I have seen, all it took to break my mind was some music, some text, and some paintings. And it is for these reasons that I will praise Urban Spook immensely. This type of horror isn't for everyone. I mean, hell, I wasn't even sure how to really feel about the series after I had first seen it. But I knew that it had worked on making me lose hours of sleep. Urban Spook showed me what it was like to be afraid again, and I will forever praise the series for having such a profound effect on me and my mind, at least for a short while. But, and this is a big but, the painter, when taken from a technical standpoint, at its core, does not have a whole lot of substance. I'm of course referring to its story, since there really isn't a whole lot to it. To say there isn't one is blatantly false, as evident by this video you are viewing right now, but the story that's there doesn't hold much weight and could be described in just a few sentences. I mean, the plot basically goes like this. Police find some spooky paintings related to recent murders, or murders that haven't been carried out yet. We get a description of that murder, and at the end of the video, we get a photo or painting of the killer themselves. Oh yeah, and there might actually be two of them. I would say it's unfair to judge the series for its story since it's still ongoing, but with the recent drop of meat, we are now 8 episodes in, and still not much has changed. The production value has remained mostly the same, with a few exceptions, like voice acting and animation being thrown into the mold, but these haven't been the big changes that I would like to see from the series moving forward. As much as I like this series, I can recognize that it doesn't have much substance, although I don't think that makes it bad by default. The basic premise and presentation is rock solid, but after 7 videos, the only thing that becomes unexpected is how brutal the next installment's kills will be, rather than how Urban Spook will push the story into new territory, and what will come next. To be honest, I feel this could be both a good and bad thing when talking about this series, because it places more emphasis on the brutal kills and paintings that the series is known for, but at the same time, it makes the story feel like it's not leading anywhere. And that's not to say that it isn't leading somewhere, but like, this is all we see. It's just text on a black background, for the most part. I am hoping that the last few episodes of the series evolve the formula that Urban Spook has built up and pushes it to new limits. I mean, just imagine the final episode goes something like this. We get a trial for the killers after they're brought to justice, and we get a nice voice acting or even live action segment with the killers testifying to their crimes. I mean, that would just be really cool. Another common criticism I hear is how Urban Spook uses the violence he portrays throughout the series. The painter presents many situations and kills that are so over the top that if you actually start to apply logic to them, the series will fall apart very quickly, and even lose a little bit of its fear factor. Like the wax kill, for instance. You just don't need to be afraid of this happening to you. It's impossible and actually a little bit silly, although creative. This probably explains why The Clue is the least scary of all the videos for me, because I just can't visualize something like this happening. I think what throws a lot of people off is that the series presents this violence in a way that makes it feel like these scenarios could happen, at least on a first-time viewing experience. It presents these brutal murders in a way that is detached and unapologetic in nature, much like actual police reports. The murders are not played for your general horror thrill. They are meant to shock and disgust you first and foremost. When you first hear about Angel, the 2-month-old baby being hung in the attic in the second episode, it's a genuine what-the-fuck moment. And then you are shown the paintings, these incredible and horrifying works created by the killer themselves, giving you just enough of a visual to imagine the insane violence that has just been explained to you, but not too much, leaving the mind racing and unable to stop thinking about the lives these killers take with such gruesome fashion. And I do want to take a quick moment to appreciate the paintings that have appeared throughout the series. For the most part, all of them have been pretty phenomenal in portraying the murders in a way that inflicts disgust just by looking at them. I mean, hell, even looking at them on their own without context will make anyone's skin crawl. Urban Spook has gone on record to say that he is an artist first and foremost, and I can definitely see how this has played a role into the creation of his series. He is an incredible visual artist, and I feel that if his art wasn't as good as it is, the series would not be nearly as terrifying. And on top of this, it still amazes me that with these visuals, how visceral the series can feel at times, even though we never actually see any of the murders happen. I mean, think about it. Everyone remembers this series for being so brutal and unforgiving, but we never actually see any of the murders take place. I was speaking with my grandmother the other day about the series and if she had seen any of it leading up to the release of this video, since, well, she's just that cool. And she told me that she had watched the Lighthouse episode, one of my personal favorites from the series. She told me that what she had seen from the series up until this point reminded her a lot of films like Psycho or Jaws, films that are highly restrained in their violence, but still extremely suspenseful and have very little blood. And while I don't think Urban Spook is quite on the level of Hitchcock or Spielberg or restrained in really any capacity when it comes to describing the kills, I believe that he uses some of the same principles due to artistic restrictions. Urban Spook works with what he's got at his disposal and manages to make these murders and their culprits terrifying with very little, and I feel that is something that should be praised. And while the simplicity hasn't been great for the storytelling, this doesn't make the series bad by default, in my opinion. Especially when it comes to analog horror. Analog horror has been happening for a good while now, and I can't remember if there was ever an analog horror story that was as grounded in reality as Urban Spook's. The fact that the series at its core is about two depraved serial killers and not some supernatural or Lovecraftian force makes it stand out, and makes it all the more scary to me, at least. Alternates are creepy, and killer planets are definitely something that would be catastrophic to say the least, but serial killers Serial killers are real. Some of you might have heard the fact that within an average person's lifetime, they will walk past at least 36 killers throughout that time. A terrifying fact for sure, but another terrifying revelation that can be made from this fact is that the only thing protecting us from these killers that we walk past in our lifetime is nothing more than a 1-inch wooden door and the prescribed feeling of false safety when we are sheltered in our homes at night, oblivious to what lurks in the dark just outside of our field of vision. With how brutal and depraved the painter can get at times, many have claimed that Urban Spook has gone too far with his videos, highlighting the brutality of the events described in his videos as going beyond the limits, especially in the analog horror community. But has Urban Spook actually gone too far? Is this series a dark reflection of Urban Spook's character? Or is he just pushing boundaries and creating new standards for horror? And how far is too far? Where do we draw the line when presenting insane violence in media? And does the violence in the painter warrant calling Urban Spook's character into question? Well, let's get one thing straight. Urban Spook is no stranger to controversy, for obvious reasons. The series and its many episodes have rattled the cages of many, but no episode more than In the Walls. This is the tape everyone refers to when throwing allegations at Urban Spook, and to be honest, when first viewing the series, I think many people are very rightly concerned when viewing this video in particular. It's almost as if Urban Spook said, "Oh, you thought hanging a baby was bad? Well, wait till you see this, kids." At least, this is how most people would interpret it. The implication between Corey's painting and the tape actually involving his death are hard to ignore, and even beyond the talk of CSA, the sheer brutality described in that video is done in a way that feels extremely tasteless. I mean, it doesn't even have a content warning at the beginning like all the other videos, and in my humble opinion, if you are going to introduce topics as heavy as brutality towards children, you have to be very respectful and extremely careful on how you implement that into your story. Urban Spook's general formula and execution are neither of these things. He does the exact same routine he did with the first two videos, explaining the deaths and all their gory details, and then leaving you to put the pieces together. Now, I understand that the video wouldn't be as shocking or scary, I guess, if Urban Spook didn't do it in the way he did, but I was already shocked before with the hanging of a 2-month-old baby. I didn't need to hear a story about 11-year-old twins being stitched together to make a sex doll. And while I like the ending sequence, where we actually get to see the killer's face in the cabin, I feel like we could have gotten this form of story progression in a different way. Again, this is all my opinion, and I do not think that Urban Spook is a bad or evil person for making this video, as many will accuse him of being, but I do not approve of how this video was handled. One of the biggest controversies stemming from this video, and actually the other videos in the series as well, is Urban Spook's merch store, in which he sells paintings from the series plastered on shirts. I mean, a pretty neat idea to make some money, to be honest. If people like your art enough, why not let them have it in a physical form? But many people have called him out on doing this, since most of the shirts contain paintings that are tied to many of the deaths in the series, and this includes Corey's painting as well. Now, I want to point out that I'm gonna give Urban Spook just a little bit of credit here, but stick with me. He is an artist first and foremost. His Instagram page will tell you that. It is obvious that the paintings come first and foremost, and then the context of them was added later. Urban Spook has gone on record that even before the series had taken off, he had made these paintings for an event called Inktober, in which he would paint a new face every day and post it on his Instagram page. Pretty much all of the paintings, including Corey's, never had context of murder victims when they were put into Urban Spook's store. He has basically made the series to promote his art first and foremost, and when dissecting the series, you can see that it's pretty much just an art show for the guy's paintings. Which, honestly, is all fine and dandy by me. But here's another thing I need to mention. It's that even if Urban Spook had Corey's painting on his store already before context was even added, he actively chose to give the context he did and left that painting up on his store for people to buy. I've seen comments from Urban Spook saying that he never expected the series to take off the way it did in the first place, and that the paintings should be looked at as their own separate art piece. But the series is big. I mean, hell, just look at the views it has. It's hard for me and everyone else to remove the context Urban Spook has given to his paintings. When I see this image, all I can think about is Corey. Whether that be a fault of the internet or Urban Spook's content, I can only think about the context behind his death. It's pretty hard to forget something so vile after all. As for the other paintings on the shirts, they don't bother me as much in a weird way, I guess. Probably because these deaths are mostly reserved for adults and they're all completely fictional. The moment you start introducing child violence into your merch, there's no doubt that people are going to start questioning your character. It doesn't help that when someone ends up criticizing Urban Spook for this, or just generally criticizing the series, Urban Spook's worst moments are usually the moments that are highlighted out on the internet for everyone to see. The most recent example of this is probably when he unloaded onto a fellow creator known as Pastra, who said, "We need to stop praising series that rely completely on shock value, much like Urban Spook's," who promptly responded by calling him an autistic cunt. Now, regardless of whose side you're standing on, it just sucks to see two content creators I personally love go at each other like this, but I had to bring it up because it is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. This is not a good look for Urban Spook. Instead of responding to the criticism with a level head, Urban Spook lashed out in a childish fashion when he could have been the bigger person. However, it does seem that after doing a little bit more research, these two have had some bad blood in the past, and this could have just been a boiling point for Urban Spook and Pastra. I'm gonna be honest though, I can't say much about it, because I haven't found much online about the feud between these two. Most of the drama has taken place over on Twitter, a site that I absolutely refuse to use. I mean, seriously, there's some actual cancer out there. But just to confirm the theory that these two have had bad blood in the past, directly after this incident, Urban Spook took to Reddit to give a little more context on why he responded the way he did. He said, "Pastra is a rat. This isn't the first time he's talked shit. Maybe I went a little hard. I don't know. As I'm sure you're aware, there has been an extreme amount of hate lately. I guess this kinda was the last straw for me. This isn't the first fairly big content creator that basically says I shouldn't have a place in the community simply because I do extreme horror. I've said it before. I'll keep calling this series Analog Horror for consistency, but as soon as it's done, I'm drawing myself away from the analog horror community. I'll keep making horror content on my channel, though. I really try to focus on all you guys who support my work instead, but it's hard sometimes. Especially since I'm still fairly new to this. Please know that I appreciate you all so much." To be honest, after researching the drama, I can kind of see where Urban Spook is coming from with this. It doesn't mean I think his response was valid or anything, I just understand the fuel behind his fire. After being criticized for months, and even being sent death threats, I believe that this was the breaking point, where a previous critic of his series comes back to throw more shade onto Urban Spook, who let out all of his emotions that had been building up to this point. I can understand that there is a real anger there. Urban Spook has entered into a community he has no knowledge about, and for months people have been telling him that he doesn't have a place within that community because his content is too extreme. Hell, I believe he's gone on record to say that he's never even seen an analog horror series before. I guess that also kind of explains why his series is so detached from the normal analog horror series that populate the internet today as well. To say that Urban Spook can't have a place within that community sounds more like a gatekeeping tactic to me, when in my opinion, I feel that the analog horror community should be actively inviting creative minds like Urban Spook, who are doing things differently. Oh yeah, and sending death threats to someone because of some videos they made is never okay. In short, from what I've seen, there are valid opinions on both sides, but there are also very nasty and disrespectful people that populate the argument, many of which have not seen the good side of Urban Spook. You know, the person who uploads and tags people who make fan art for his series, the person who watches and comments on reaction videos to his content, the person who responds to valid criticism with respect. Hell, the person who tagged me on Instagram, essentially helping my last video get over 3,000 views in just above 2 days. Urban Spook is not a bad person, and that much is clear to me. And even if that opinion were to change, I can still enjoy the painter regardless. But to ask the important question, again, how far is too far? I think the answer is one that might leave us all a little unsatisfied, but There really isn't a solid answer to that question. There's a great video about this by Dead Hats that I will link below that goes over this metaphorical line and where we draw it. He explains it better than I ever could, but basically came to the same conclusion that I've had for a while now. That line is one that is unique to each of us. It is something that we decide for ourselves, and it depends heavily on the context of the media we are covering. I personally believe that if the media in question is not bringing real harm to the viewers or those creating it, then the artist should feel free to experiment with the boundaries as long as they are being respectful about it. When it comes to a video like In the Walls, I find it hard to believe that Urban Spook is condoning any type of violence towards children or fantasizing about it. I mean, hell, I find it hard to believe that he's condoning any of the violence in his series. I believe he's even said that such subjects terrify him. And if Urban Spook's goal is to terrify the viewer, then it seems obvious he would use things that disgust him as motivation. Because if it disgusts the guy who's making it, then Lord only knows what it's gonna do to us. I don't condone the way In the Walls was handled, but I don't think in any way it shows proof that Urban Spook is a bad or evil person. With the newest episode, Meat, dropping not too long ago, I am ever curious to see how Urban Spook wraps up this story and what the future holds for his work moving forward. I will eagerly be awaiting the next installment.
Oh, you guys are still here? Why? Don't you have anything, like better to do? This video was an hour long and you're still here. Well, I guess if you're still here, then I might as well say something. You know what's funny about this is that I had something to say for this segment of the video. I forgot. The merch is pretty cool. Quick merch review. The hoodie is nice and comfy. I wish the print was a little bit like bigger, maybe a little bit brighter, but it still looks cool. You can tell what that is, right? He's just a happy boy. Look at him. Happy boy. Whew, that was a long video, and I'm sorry if its length wasn't justified or if it was boring at all. This is my first time doing a big analysis video, so it's still very new to me. So if it's a little rough around the edges, I'm sorry. I don't know how to make these yet. But if you're still here and you're still listening to me talk, I appreciate you putting up with me for that amount of time and listening to me talk about something that I enjoy. So yeah, if it isn't evident already, I guess I kind of like Urban Spook, just to get that out of the way. I like the series. What can I say? There are some people out there who will be like, I can't understand how anyone would actually enjoy the series unironically. And it's like, well, there's a certain subgroup of pretty messed up individuals, such as myself, who actually do find enjoyment out of something like that. But I do want to say that, you know, everything in this video is solely my opinion. I tried to come into it just from a very open-minded perspective, but opinions are obviously going to leak through. And if you disagree with any of those, that's completely fine. And feel free to let me know how you disagree with me in the comments, or if you agree with me. I want to open up some discussion about this topic. And yeah, I think that that's important. But yeah, if you disagree, or even if you agreed with any of the stuff that I said in this video, feel free to comment down below. I like to consider myself a pretty chill person when it comes to criticism. If you have any talking points, or if there was any talking points that I made that you don't agree with or you thought were lackluster, feel free to let me know. I really don't care when it comes to criticism. Just let me know. I'll take it with a level head as long as you are respectful. I don't want to see any arguments being thrown around in my comments section. I want to see some discussion, whether it be with me or any fellow commenters. Just be respectful, okay guys? I also want to say thank you to just everyone who has subscribed recently. We like got up to 200 subscribers. The last Urban Spook video I did, which was the reaction video, popped the fuck off. I mean, holy crap, that is a lot of viewers, more than I've ever had. That's like my most viewed video now. So thanks for everyone who watched that, and for everyone who left a comment. All the comments on that video were super nice. Everyone was sharing theories. People were respectfully, you know, discussing amongst themselves, and you know, me as well. And yeah, I just want to say thanks for that. That was really nice. I've never experienced that on YouTube before. I also want to say to the new subscribers, I just want to let you all know going forward that my life is very busy at the moment, currently working a day job as well as doing college. And as anyone who has been in college knows, and I'm sure that there are people who will watch these videos that are, it never rests. It's basically a second job. I also, you can see that guy. Oh. That guy back there. I am a guitar player. I'm trying to better my skills with that. So YouTube is pretty much coming secondary to everything. This is just a fun hobby that I've started doing about a couple years back or so. I don't know how long this channel's been going. But I want to firstly apologize because I'm very inconsistent with uploads. Although if I go away for a while, it's not because I'm going away fully. I'm not abandoning this channel. It's just probably because I'm very busy and there's like a group project due in the next 2 hours. But later on, maybe when I get my degree, I'll start doing this more consistently. You guys just decide to stick with me. I appreciate it. And yeah, just thank you all. Thank you all. All right. Well, other than that, I'm really tired. This video took way too long to get done. I kind of want to just put it behind me now and just wait for the next video, and I'm gonna go sleep. So I'll leave you with this. Just stay safe out there. Make sure to lock your doors at night so that no one breaks in and paints you in a gruesome depiction of your death. That would not be good. And if you want to subscribe, I mean, go ahead. I don't really care. If you do though, go ahead and hit that bell so that you get notified whenever I upload. But I mean, you guys already know that. This is common sense. Every single YouTuber on the face of this platform has said that at least one time. So you guys know what's up. Just stay safe out there, and yeah, thank you. Bye.